Abdul, stay quiet and agree with simple premises first. Can you please agree in public that Quran denies the historicity of the Passover?
Okay. Jesus said, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you. So let's fight together. Come on.
Let's go.
Not only has Jesus returned after 1 month, it doesn't tally up with other gospel writers who has Jesus in Egypt for some 3 years.
You are claiming Luke's account of the census is fiction. I am saying in all these 3 points, you have employed logical fallacies.
The first lesson you need to learn about Jesus to love.
Okay.
Then to ask questions. Yeah. Yes. If you want to learn about Jesus, learn to love. Learn to love others. Learn to love others. Yeah, come on. Let's hug together. Let's hug together. That's the evil spirit of Islam. That's the evil spirit of Islam. Because he don't follow the teaching of Jesus.
I am speaking to you.
How can you learn about Jesus?
My question, is this. In your Christian Bible, do you believe in your Christian Bible, yes or no?
Bible is the word of God. Yes, I do believe.
Do you believe? Hey, what are you insulting? Okay, you tell me, was Jesus son of Mary? Now you answer my question. What Jesus son of Mary?
Oh, you love Jesus? Yes. Come on, hug. Okay. Come on, hug. Hug Christian. Come on, hug Christian. Hug Christian. That's the love of Jesus. Come on, that's the love of Jesus. Come on, hug me. Hug me if you love Jesus.
Okay.
If you love Jesus, Jesus said, love your enemy. Jesus said, love your enemy. Jesus said, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you. So let's fight together. Come on.
Let's push him.
If you want to learn about Jesus, the first step of Jesus is this. The first step of Jesus is this. Love your enemy.
Okay, quiet.
Come on.
Quiet.
Come on.
Come on.
Our disagreement is not on the deity. Our disagreement is on basic historical facts.
Find me any historian that believes Jesus Christ was resurrected.
Exactly.
If you can find me,
Peter.
Paul. Peter isn't a historian.
How do you define
Peter
historian?
I'm not a historian.
How do you define a historian?
Do you have the workings of Peter?
How do you define a historian? Someone who writes a historical account.
Okay, where is Peter's account?
Someone who writes a systematic historical account of something is a historian.
Okay.
Was he an eyewitness?
You asked me, are there historical accounts of the resurrection? I said yes, and I gave a few. Peter's accounts.
Paul's accounts, Matthew's
were
account,
any of them eyewitnesses?
Mark's account, Luke's account.
None of them were eyewitnesses. None. None of them.
Would you please join in the conversation when he's
Well, you two are speaking, so I think we two can speak.
Right.
It's only fair.
Allow me to speak. Right. I asked you whether or not any historian believes in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, right? Who has the worthy of being called a historian.
Peter,
right?
Luke.
An accolade. Hold on. Because historians work on a naturalistic worldview.
This is silly.
No.
Who told you that?
I'm telling you. Historians told me that. Okay? Historians work on a naturalistic worldview, not on a supernatural worldview.
Who says that? This is silly. If that is the definition, there could be no historical account of God. If that is the definition.
So,
because historians...
Historical account of God. I promise you, no historian has ever made an historical argument for the existence of God.
Stick to my statement, please.
I think he's getting mixed up with the theology.
Stick to my statement, please.
He's supposed to be the Christian for the Christians.
The statement I am making is, if historians stick only to naturalistic worldview, there could not be any historical account of God.
That's called a theology. Right. Get your facts right, Arul.
That's called
learn the difference between a historian and a theologian.
So let's put it this way. Coming out of that pedantic point.
Pedantic, it's not pedantic.
Jesus died.
This is what you brought up actually.
Alive. This is history.
Okay. Do you agree? Hold on. Jesus died and was resurrected. Right, hold on.
Do you agree? In his proofs, he's immortal.
So you're making a claim that he was crucified, right? Forget whether or not historical or not, right? Let's theologically.
No, stick to the history first.
Theologically.
We don't differ on theology first.
Okay.
We differ on history first.
So who are the eyewitnesses first of this history?
So jumping.
Who are the eyewitnesses?
Muslims.
None. They all ran away, remember?
Dawood and Christians.
Okay. Who's making this historical
differ
claim?
Differ on history first.
Exactly,
okay,
history
who's
first
making this historical claim?
So jumping, Abdul.
You said it's a historical proof.
Forget about this nonsense. Answer a simple question. Do you agree that Jesus died, came back alive?
Cite me the historian that is making this claim. Who's witness to this?
Historical records that we have. Matthew.
Okay, I do not accept the works of Matthew because Matthew and Luke, you just mentioned Luke, make fictitious historical claims.
Explain.
I'll explain.
Luke was not even a disciple.
For example, Luke, regarding the birth of Jesus Christ, says, right, that there was a world census, right? Caesar had called for a census.
You yourself
hold on,
not...
Hold on, allow me to speak. For this census, everyone had to go back to their ancestral home. Joseph and Mary lived in Nazareth. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. To make Jesus to be born in Bethlehem, he makes a fictitious story up about a census, making Jesus go all the way from Nazareth to Bethlehem to be born. We know this to be a lie because there is no evidence outside of the Bible and Christian scripture that this thing ever took place. Imagine that. There was a census in 2011. There's going to be a census next year.
Right?
They say you all have to go to your ancestral home for this census. Avril, where are you going to go? You're going to go back to India, Pakistan, or Bangladesh, or Sri Lanka?
Please make your point quick.
To do this census, the Roman world had to go back to their ancestral home. Now, David, right, was 1,000 years prior to Joseph. 1,000 years. Can you tell me who your ancestor was 1,000 years ago? Name me.
Can you please make your point quick?
I do not accept Luke's historical account since he makes history up.
Dawood stands in a public place and he wants to give a very, very sensible point apparently, and he says Caesar ordered a census. Are you sure it was Caesar who ordered that census according to
Luke? Do you have your Bible?
Please.
Do you have your Bible?
Before I take the Bible, are you willing to say if it wasn't Caesar who ordered that census that you don't know what you're talking about?
Yeah, that's right.
Now, are you willing to agree?
Am I willing to agree?
You said you are portraying yourself, you're showing up yourself as an expert commentator on this case. And your expert commentary.
He's giving his opinion. He's an expert.
I don't care about opinions. I care about
you give your opinion.
He's trying.
Okay, perfect.
Dawood. Let me make my point.
Hold on.
I held on for a long time for you to finish your point.
No, go.
You wanted to portray Luke as a person who comes up with fictitious history. You wanted to do that. And to aid your case, you said Luke talks about a census that the Caesar. Before you Google search. Before you refer to your prophet Google, please. You said you, to aid your case, were talking about a census that Caesar ordered.
I'm requesting you not to look at
Google now. Before you agree on something, please.
Okay.
Can I request something to Google?
And the agreement is, if the point is you can't find a censor that Caesar ordered in the book of Luke, can we conclude that you don't know what you're talking about? Okay. Can we conclude that's the question you've asked.
Now allow me to reply. Now he's asking me whether or not me saying it was Caesar or whether or not there was a census in the Holy Roman Empire, right? As written in Luke, it does not in any way, shape or form dilute or alter my argument.
It does because you don't know what you're talking about.
You're playing the person, not the ball.
No, I'm not playing the person. I'm making a simple point. If it wasn't Caesar, he'll say it's wrong. I'm not playing the person. I'd explain you why. If it wasn't Caesar, as you portrayed, it would. I'm not playing the person. I'm playing the point that you don't know what you're talking about.
If it was Caesar, what are you going to do? Never come to this park ever again?
Hold on. If it's about the ability, if it's not about the pussy,
you said you're playing the ball. I'm gonna play the way you're playing.
Guys, let's not get our egos in. Whoever's wrong, we'll just say I'm wrong and move on. Come on.
Who ordered the census?
The census was ordered by Caesar, but it was during.
After all that.
Wait, what did I say?
I want to know if you know what you're talking about.
You earlier implied that it wasn't Caesar. And you went into a whole hoopla about nothing, basically.
Do you know what you're talking about?
And then he talks about historians.
Okay, hold up. I don't know. Okay, let's calm down and cool down. Let's not raise our voices over. Plain and simple. Was there a census ordered by Caesar the man himself or his right-hand man or his administrators across the Roman world as it was known back then? According to Luke, for everyone to go to their ancestral home, therefore causing Mary and Joseph to go to Bethlehem for a census that we know never occurred.
I know it occurred. You think it never occurred.
So can you bring the evidence that this occurred, please?
The Bible.
Because
historical evidence.
Historical.
The Bible.
I already said.
Why is the Bible not historical evidence?
I already said, outside of the Bible.
You appeal to history instead of theology.
Because Luke is the only one that says this. No one else says this.
So what?
Luke is making up a historical claim. That's why I asked you the simple question. Aru, in 2021, there's going to be a census in this country.
Do you know what fiction means? Hold on.
If they say in the census, everyone has to go to their ancestral home for this census, where are you going to go, Aru? Are you going to go to India, Pakistan, or Bangladesh, or Sri Lanka? tell me what is the logical reason of a census sending all its citizens to their ancestral home to find out where they came from? The only reason why Luke did this, because he needed Jesus to be born in Bethlehem to fulfill a prophecy in the Old Testament. That is the only reason why he made up this historical fictitious claim.
So let me try and understand.
At the very start, he's got a basic thing wrong, the birth of Christ. Why should I accept the very end of Christ from Luke and Matthew and John and Mark?
So your point is something like this, yeah? You think for a census which happened in the first century, it doesn't make sense for as part of the census for people to go back to their homeland. It does not make sense, and therefore it could not have happened. It's fiction. That seems to be your point.
Okay. Either you misunderstood what I said. Right. For example, how would a census know whether or not Joseph's ancestors were from Bethlehem?
How would
they ever know? What is the benefit, even though that wasn't my argument, what is the benefit of holding a census of where someone's ancestral people came from
to know,
if you don't already have a record of where their ancestors were from? If there are no documents of Arul from India, me saying Arul has to go to India, Pakistan, Bangladesh or Sri Lanka to register for a census is pointless. The only reason to do that was if BNP wanted to kick you out and make sure you don't get back in again.
This is silly. That was silly for Luke to make that story up just so he could have Jesus born in Bethlehem. You are making a statement time and time again. You are saying Luke made that story up. You use the term fiction. And I'm assuming you know what a fiction means. Fiction is something which purely has been imagined in someone's mind. Do you have a proof that Luke had purely imagined this, as opposed to saying it is possible he imagined this?
Yeah? He's made that point many times already.
Now, what is the proof that it is pure fiction when Luke talks about that, and the fact of the people of his time reading that and being quite happy with that account? Number one. Number two, you are saying the census sending people back to their homelands does not make sense. I am saying that is not true. It could very genuinely make sense. And the sense that it could make is this kind of census hasn't taken place before. This is the first time we need. We have no precedence. So the best thing we can rely upon is essentially the societal pressure making sure that people are going to go to their right places of origin. So, for example, if a similar census is ordered today, and if I suddenly showed up in Scotland, and if I said this is my ancestral home, hopefully the Scottish would look at me and say, oh, you don't look like me, you don't belong, you don't seem to belong here, and therefore they could catch me out. So, in other words, when there is no precedence of such a census, when for the first time a census of this nature is ordered, and when Caesar wants to know how many Jewish people are around, how many Edomites are around, how many Ammonites, Moabites are around, he might very well order a census where he thinks the societal pressure would make sure that he gives a reasonably right figure. Such a census was ordered, recorded by Luke,
and no other historian.
There are other historians. I'll come to that.
2 points. I understand your thing. We'll do two.
I'll come to that.
Two at a time, please.
No.
Not a third. Two at a time.
By the way, he'll stand out in Scotland, but not in England.
Extra biblical evidence. There is extra biblical evidence for such a census to have taken place. Extra biblical evidence exists. But what you need to do now, is clearly explain, not give conjectural arguments, clearly explain how this is purely imaginary.
Okay, right. So you made 2 points. The first point I'll deal with, right? So the reason why also Luke's story is made up is when you look at the birth of Christ with The same story in Matthew, we see it doesn't tally up.
Can you stick to
I am.
Can you stick to the census, please?
Hold on, I am.
Hold
on.
You wanted to make only 2 points.
Allow me to. Right. So, Jesus ends up in Bethlehem according to this census, right? According to Luke, Mary's there only for 1 month, right? For the ritual bathing after giving birth. Jesus is also circumcised after 8th day. And then thereafter, they return back to Bethlehem. Right? Sorry, return back to Nazareth.
Thereafter, they go to Egypt. And after a long time they go to Nazareth.
You've mixed up two gospels and made your own gospel.
No.
Because Matthew, I didn't interrupt you.
Dawood,
I didn't interrupt you.
Please get back to our original point.
I am.
Explain how Luke's account of such a census happening is fiction. Explain the fiction part, please.
Right. So he has Mary, Joseph and Jesus return back to Nazareth after 1 month. If we read the same story, the birth of Christ, in Matthew, we see that the reason why they were there is Herod was ordered to the killing of children, and Joseph and Mary and Jesus, after a dream, go to Egypt. They return back after hearing the death of King Herod. Yeah? After the death of King Herod. Yeah, sorry, I did pronounce it correctly. Then they return back. Yeah, so Matthew has Jesus, Joseph, and Mary go to Egypt, whilst Luke, after 1 month, has Jesus, Joseph, and Mary return back to Nazareth.
Right? Jesus, Luke doesn't have that.
Hold on, yes, it does.
No.
Are you sure? Are you willing to?
Yeah.
I won't waste time.
Dawood. Look, let's come back to the fiction part. Let's come to the fiction part.
Point out that fact.
Explain. Dawood.
Hold on.
Please explain how the occurrence of this census is fiction, please.
I am, Arul. If you allow me. I'm dealing with both your points, okay? And if you allow me to...
You're adding a new point here.
The census of Quirinius was a census of
Cyrenius.
That's a Q.
Quirinius, Cyrenius.
Pronounce as you please. Taken by Publius Sulpicius Quirinius, Roman governor of Syria, upon the imposition of direct Roman rule in Judea in 6th century. The Gospel of Luke places the birth of Jesus during the reign of Herod the Great, Luke 1:15 records, who died 9 years before the earliest possible date of the census. No plausible resolution of this contradiction seems possible, and most scholars think that the author of the Gospel made a mistake.
Read the last bit again. No
plausible resolution of this contradiction seems possible, and most scholars think
Dawood, I'm looking for your explanation for how the occurrence of such a census was fictional.
Let me finish with the first point.
He just read it.
No.
Let me finish with the first point.
What is the first point? You're adding as many points as you want.
First point.
Fiction, please.
By the way, census fiction.
Sorry, Luke 1:5. So, I'm dealing with your first point. So, Luke, not only has Jesus returned after 1 month, it doesn't tally up with other gospel writers who has Jesus in Egypt for some 3 years. Yeah? So either Luke is mistaken or Matthew is mistaken. At what point did Jesus, Joseph and Mary return back to Bethlehem? 1 month according to Luke or years later according to Matthew? Moreover.
Well, that wasn't my first point. I never spoke about where they were returning. You're just imagining things in your mind.
No, you said how did Luke make a mistake?
Let me repeat again. If it wasn't clear, if you listen again, please.
Okay, yeah.
You said the occurrence of the census, this particular census, the occurrence of that was fiction.
Yep.
The question I'm asking is, explain how the occurrence of such a census was fiction in light of Luke recording that,
the answer is
extra biblical sources
or it says the Gospel of Luke, read from it. That's the answer to your question.
Is this some sort of an exam where you want to give him answers?
No, it's because you keep repeating the same question, and instead of going in circles, you might as well
so
answer
question,
the question.
Right, question okay. Dawood is yeah. simple.
Right.
You claimed the census.
The answer is that, where it says the Gospel of Luke.
The Gospel of Luke places the birth of Jesus during the reign of Herod the Great, Luke 1:5, who died 9 years before the earliest possible date of the census.
There you go. That's your answer. You keep repeating so many times. Can you answer that question
explain,
now?
Explain, please.
Okay.
I'll come back to the same question.
I'll do it in the most simplest of English, so even everyone can understand.
Do what?
Right?
Do what? What are you going to
I'm
do?
I'm going to explain how the census is fictitious, right? It's going to allude to what Brother...
9 years before the earliest possible date of the census.
So, that's the census never occurred because we have no historical evidence outside of the Bible and Christian writing of this occurring. Now, I want you to understand, you said you know history, right? The Roman Empire, we're talking about antiquity here, right? The Roman Empire, as advanced as they were, I want you to be able to describe to me the administrative skill and level required for people to migrate from great distances. Do you know the Roman Empire, how big it was during the first century? We're talking about the whole Mediterranean being under the control of the Romans. And they're holding a census from literally the east coast of Africa to the west coast of Spain, right? All of that, even modern day Morocco, they controlled all of that. There is no evidence of anyone for moving for a census across the Roman world in the first century. Now, moreover, the contradiction between these two things. Herod, right, Jesus, there's the 9 year gap, right? The census being, Herod being dying in 4th century before BC, yeah? Sorry, year 4 BC, yeah? And the census holding in 6 AD after Jesus. These two historical things do not tally up either, right? If Matthew is right that Herod died in 4 BC, yeah, and Luke is right that the census occurred at the reign of the Syrian king Quirinus, who was around 6 AD, then you have a gap of 10 years, and these two years do not tally up, which proves again more that Matthew and Luke make things up in order to fulfill prophecies from the Old Testament or their own Christological beliefs. Right?
And you know, you have made
this ain't my opinion. Don't play the person, play the bull.
This is the opinion of Raymond Brown, who is a prominent scholar of Christianity.
If you can stay quiet.
And he says most scholars. So three things that the author of the gospel made a mistake.
Three specific points you have made,
Raymond Brown.
Point number one: no extra biblical sources talk about this, and therefore it's fictitious.
Raymond Brown.
It's fictitious.
A prominent scholar. Can I please of Christianity?
I haven't stopped you.
You made three specific points. No extra biblical source talks about this, and therefore the Bible must be a fiction in this regard.
Not the therefore. I didn't say that.
What's that?
I didn't say the therefore bit. I'm saying. This isn't made up because there's no evidence outside of it. There's evidence of everything contrary to it outside of the Bible.
That's your second point and third point. You made three distinct points. You can check out the recording later if you want to. The first point you made was, this is fictitious because no one else says this. That was your first point. Your second point was, this is fictitious because pragmatically this is less likely to have happened. That was your second point. Your third point is, this is fictitious because I know a census happened later on and therefore this census could not have happened. These are the three specific points you made, and based on these three points you are claiming Luke's account of the census is fiction. I am saying in all these three points you have employed logical fallacies. Number one, the first point, no one else says the same thing, and therefore this is fiction. If we apply that to the Quran, the entirety of the Quran would straight away. If your logical point was, no one else says this and therefore this must be fiction, if that is a logical point, that point would apply to many, many literature. Unless they have exactly similar copies outside of them, they would be fiction. No one else says this and therefore you are lying. No one else says this and therefore you are talking fiction. That was your first point. Complete logical fallacy. It's pretty much like saying no one else, Dawood, you can't be Dawood because there is no one else who is the same Dawood. Just doesn't make sense. Point number two, you said pragmatically it's challenging for people to move around and therefore this could not have happened. Now what I do know historically is that this census happened in the land of Israel and in the surrounding area. That I do know through the account of the Bible. Whether it happened in Italy, whether it happened elsewhere.
What does Luke say? What does Luke say?
Can I finish, please? Can I finish, please? Yeah. Where else it happened? I don't know. But even, the point is simple. Even, let's say, it happened right through the Roman Empire. The point is, if people have moved one way, why can't they move the reverse way? If someone from Africa has moved to Italy, it simply means that movement was possible, which means the reverse movement must be possible. So you say it's impossible, it's just wrong. Point number two. Point number three. You said, I know of a census by this person which happened later, and therefore this census could not have happened. Again, is a logically fallacious point. By that logic, the moment we have, let's say, the census of 1919,
further away from the screaming is shouting.
By that logic, the moment
further down, yeah. We don't want you guys to shout unnecessarily.
Any censuses that happened before them would have been fictitious because we know this happened and therefore they could not have happened. That was your logic. I agree. There was a census which happened later on also, and the census which happened later on was managed in that region by the same Quirinius, and that is recorded by Josephus. In the Antiquities of Jews, he records of Quirinius conducting that census later on. I agree with that. But the point is, a record of a later census does not mean no census happened before that. If that is what you imply, that will be a silly point. Now, coming back to my important question. The question is, you know what a fiction is. A fiction is not something which you doesn't think happened. A fiction is rather something which is imaginary according to standard definition. The question to you is, why did you claim this census was a fiction when a later census doesn't mean the earlier census did not happen? Luke records that. Josephus records Quirinius as someone who conducted such censuses.
He's talking about the time period.
And thirdly, when one way movement is possible, obviously the reverse movement should also be possible. As long as something is possible, why do you say it is fiction? Your point was, it is impossible. I am saying it is possible. And therefore, you claiming it's a fiction.
So in other words.
So if, just to humor the atmosphere. You were born so you can go back into your mother's womb again.
You
just use the logic.
Exactly.
If one way movement is possible, the opposite is possible.
I was obviously referring to geographical movement, not the
joking.
Birth.
Calm down. Calm down.
No. You're, I know you throw in sleight of hand comments like that.
That's not
as if that
you
makes
just
sense.
Met me. Calm.
If you can come from Camberwell to Hyde Park, it means you have the ability to come from Camberwell to Hyde Park, and therefore you must also have the ability to go from Hyde Park to Camberwell. That's my point.
I was
geographical movement.
I did say at the start, I'm just making a joke. I wasn't.
As long as you agree, that is an irrelevant joke, that's fine.
I said at the start, it was just a joke.
But anyway, irrelevant. Unconnected to our conversation.
Okay.
Calm down.
Now. Sorry, did you want to?
Yeah, it says here, most scholars think that the author of the gospel made a mistake with regards
most
to Luke 1:5.
Most scholars thinking does not mean it's fiction.
This is not most some scholar. This is a prominent scholar of Christianity, Raymond Brown, and everyone knows him. You should know him. Unless you're telling me you know better than Raymond Brown. And
I think
provide
Quran
more
is wrong.
Evidence.
Sir, can we conclude Quran is wrong?
Sorry? You must give your substantiation for it to be wrong. We
which
can't just
what
make
I'm
a claim.
Expecting from you. Don't
no,
give
this
me
is just a claim. Raymond Brown
give
is not some nobody. He's a prominent Christian scholar. And you cannot say that if he says that most scholars think that the author of the Gospel of Luke made a mistake.
That would you said fiction. Do you appreciate it's not fiction? And would you like to take your point back?
He's just capitalizing on the word fiction.
Now, no. I would perfectly stand by the word fiction purely because it's not my words, right? Biblical scholar. No.
You can get
sorry.
Your list later.
Hold on.
The point is, someone somewhere saying it's fiction does not mean something is a fiction.
I was debating with a Canadian Christian.
On this point.
On this point. Yeah. And it came up, right?
I'm sure he's not the only one.
The point came up and therefore it's fiction.
Michael something, right?
So can you bring any scholars who agrees with it?
Hold on.
Do you know what a fiction is, Dawood? Do you know what...
That's it. Michael Lacona.
Do you know what a fiction is?
Please, one person at a time. Let's keep it simple, right?
So Lacona is debating Barham.
Right? And this point came up, right? And Barham goes through the whole Bible. Start, middle, end. Sorry, I say whole Bible. Parts of Jesus Christ, how it's all fiction. Yeah? For example, sorry, I say the word fictional. He used the word fictional, but I if you get offended by that, I'll use another word.
I'm
right?
not offended hold by on. Any how, words. I am offended okay. by the fact that you are unable to back up your claim,
okay,
yet you insist on claiming
again.
That.
Okay, I won't
again.
Use the word fictional, I'll use the word historically
use
inaccurate.
Use any word you want to
why shout?
If you I'm can substantiate. Okay. When you can't substantiate, give up. Forget about shouting, not shouting. When you can't substantiate, give up, please.
Calm down. Right. So, allow me to speak, please. Right. So, it was a brilliant debate. Absolutely wonderful. He goes through the historical inaccuracies of the birth of Christ, how Luke and Matthew make up stories or historical inaccuracies in order to fulfill prophecies and fill in the gaps of rumors that were
this debate is
we're not debating, we're conversing. This is
if it's conversation, if it's conversation, I really want you to use words and expressions which you can substantiate and then use those words and expressions.
I'm giving an account of a debate between two scholars.
Don't say this is made up.
Please don't shout at me. Okay,
you can
only
say
my parents
that's his
are
opinion.
To shout at me.
This is speaker's corner.
You're not my
freedom
father
speech,
or mother.
Remember?
Please do not shout at me.
You
okay?
can say.
I say that politely. Right?
If he says the Quran is wrong, he can say Bible is wrong.
I'm citing historical inaccuracies. Remember, that's how the conversation began. Historical evidences of the life of Christ.
The conversation began when we asked a simple question, whether you agree with the historicity of the death, burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Okay.
And when we were speaking about that, you said Luke gives fictitious accounts.
I asked for historical evidence. You gave me Luke. I said Luke makes up fictitious accounts.
And there, I'm challenging you.
If you're gonna,
so
I'm
Luke's
challenging
account is wrong,
you.
That means you can have other things.
Challenging
not
you.
Not only that. Does
I'm
not
challenging
Luke's,
you
hold on,
to explain.
I am. Not only
why,
does Luke's story of the same event not tally up with his own self and his historical evidence outside of the Bible.
Explain,
but
please.
With
explain
even,
how the census is
with even evidence from the Bible. For example, Luke and Matthew do not match. That's just the birth of Christ.
Explain how the census
what was
is fictitious.
Hold on. According to Luke, Joseph and Mary and Jesus was in Bethlehem because of a census. According to Matthew, why were they in Bethlehem? Why were they in Bethlehem and why did they go to Egypt? Totally different reasons. they're making up stories in order for Jesus to be born in Bethlehem. But hold
on. No, Dawood, I'm not here to listen to your nonsense here. The question is simple.
Yeah.
Explain to me.
Can you bring me evidence outside of Luke that there was a census across the whole Roman world?
Why should I?
Because Luke is making a claim.
You appealed on historicity.
Yeah, Luke is making a claim.
Now you're denying
that claim is very viable.
Do you attest to that claim? Hold on. Do you attest to that claim?
I attest to that claim.
Right. Based
on the evidences that I'm going to give you.
Right. Okay. Hold on.
Based on the evidences that I'm going
to give you.
I think Luke's account is very, very
inaccurate.
Viable. Number one, he writes an account in the first century, and first century readers are reading it. There is no one who opposes this account. Number one. Number two, he writes of an event and refers to a historical person called Quirinius of Syria who managed the census of that land. And that particular person has been recorded by Josephus, and the special qualification of that person, according to Josephus, seems like he is someone who is used to conducting such censuses. So, based on the point that Luke records, Luke records contemporaries were happy. We have Josephus recording that person was someone who did similar censuses. I'm quite happy with that account. If you think it is still a fiction, you need to give me solid evidences. Not tell me Bart Ehrman has grievances, Tom Dick and Harry has grievances, all sorts of other people have grievances.
Scholars have grievances.
To the historicity.
They say most scholars disagree with Luke.
Do you know what most
Raymond
means?
Brown.
Even if most is true, do you know what most means?
Most means they have done the research.
It is not
and they're
all.
Scholars.
Okay. Most means it is not all.
The remaining are Christian scholars that don't want to.
No, Raymond Brown is a Christian scholar. And he's quite prominent.
But hold on. Right.
Oh, finally got some help.
No. I gave you three cases, I think, already. Number one, Luke records that.
Yeah.
His contemporaries were happy with that account.
That's it. Conjecture, you don't know that.
Exactly.
No.
In fact, we don't even know if Luke wrote that.
Do you know of a contemporary account?
You do not know.
You don't have the first
you
century
can't state from you silence. Can't state from silence, you can't claim evidence,
yes.
Right? Just because everyone else was quiet doesn't mean it's true.
Can I repeat my point, please? One second. Luke records that, despite the fact that Jesus and his history was a very controversial history of that time. We know there is no opposing viewpoint raised about this particular census. I'm purely talking about the census. This particular census, no opposing viewpoint raised.
That's your claim.
True.
Exactly. It's an argument from silence.
Can I?
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't.
It doesn't.
Absolutely. And add to that, Josephus speaks about this particular Quirinius, and the qualification he gives to that Quirinius is that he has conducted such censuses. That is his.
You have to assume that they knew this story. You have to prove that they knew.
Can we come
the
to
story
the
story of the census? And they did. They remained silent. They did not object.
No,
neither you can prove.
Not the only on its own.
So you claiming it's a fictitious account is just absolute nonsense. Can we come to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus? We can do the death of Jesus, the burial of Jesus, and the resurrection of Jesus.
We can do.
I want historical events.
For two different reasons, right? I want to speak about the death, crucifixion, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Yeah?
I don't necessarily trust the census of that.
Historical claim of Jesus being crucified. According to John,
when was Jesus crucified? Including Raymond Brown,
on the day after the Passover meal or the day before the Passover meal?
So can you answer my
question? I'm asking you a simple question. Right? You wanted to bring it to the death, crucifixion, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. I did want to talk about one topic, but if you're going to go, I'll talk about that first topic. Right? So according to Christians, Jesus is the Lamb of God. Yeah? and they
what's happening here? Are you going to talk about the death, burial,
I am.
Research?
I am. Because
the historicity.
I am. Calm down. Because it was going to walk away. I'm just going to talk about this point regarding the death, crucifixion, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. According to Christians, Jesus is the Lamb of God, right? And he's the Lamb of God, according to John, is because he died at the very same time as the lambs were being sacrificed in the temple. Yeah? So therefore, Jesus is the Lamb of God. He's the Lamb that takes away the sin, representing the Passover Lamb. You know the Passover Lamb?
When Moses, can you please teach me these things?
I would love to but I'd rather teach you Islam.
Let's move on.
Then
historicity,
things that won't save you on the day of Qiyamah. I am.
Hold historicity on. Of
please,
the death,
I'm not, I don't
burial,
shout.
Doesn't matter.
It
can
does.
You come to the point, please? Historicity. Don't give me a lecture on why Jesus was.
By the way,
the
just
lamb.
To correct you, it wasn't on the day of Passover.
Why don't you have
sacrifice
for
the atonement? It was on Yom Kippur. So apparently Jesus was crucified at the wrong time because he was apparently crucified on the day of Passover.
Yeah.
With the atonement sins, sorry, the sacrifice on the day of
Passover,
which was Yom Kippur. And he should go and ask the Jewish people element, because they'll correct him. Anyway, I think you want to finish something?
Yes, I want to finish this point. So Jesus is the Lamb, representing the Lamb of the Lamb of Passover, when the final plague on Egypt, where God killed every firstborn. Yeah? Now I want to ask you this, plain and simple. Is it just, since you are a Trinitarian Christian, is it
so
just,
you have not, you're going to do nothing about the historicity of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus?
It is history.
You haven't got anything from this.
Calm down. Calm down.
Forget about giving me nonsensical. Stop patronizing comments.
It's not patronizing.
You're the one. Are you
you're
going
shouting.
To,
I haven't shouted once.
Yeah. Doesn't matter.
I promise you, regardless
you
whether it's cameras or not, I promise you, I've got a bigger God than you have. But I'm not shouting.
Are
right?
you going to discuss
please,
about the historicity
am,
of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus
Christ?
Can we
converse and not shout? Please. Sorry? Okay, let's not use raised voices. If we can speak at the same volume as Ray does, I'd love it.
But what we're trying to say is,
that's the volume I would love to speak
at.
Right? Can we do that?
Just one point. Rather than going down some peripheral point, let's kick to the core point first and foremost, and whether you believe the historicity of the death and burial and resurrection of Christ. Yes or no to that?
I'm linking it to that.
No, you're taking the peripheral points.
I'm taking it to the very beginning.
No, start with the belief of it first.
I'm taking it, I'm dealing holistically.
You're using
right?
some peripheral areas.
I promise you, I'm linking it holistically. Together,
but
right?
The core
patience is all
you're
I'm asking
out,
for.
I'm
a little
saying.
Bit of patience.
Yeah,
right?
But just what I'm saying.
If you appreciate that? The fact that how can God kill innocent children, the firstborn of innocent children, right, who are not in
just
control,
like the tyrant Herod did.
Exactly. Who are not in control of the Jews. It was Pharaoh who was in control of the Jews. So this Jesus, as a Trinitarian Christian, you believe, kills the firstborn of innocent people who aren't captives, who aren't enslaving his people, the Israelites, and he punishes them by killing their firstborn.
Killing babies, yeah?
Literally, their firstborn. Not just of humans, of animals. Right, of animals as well. Animals, the firstborn of animals also die. According
I'm assuming
to Exodus,
somewhere you're going to talk
I
about
am,
the historicity
I
of the
am.
Death,
allow me,
burial, and resurrection
allow
of
me.
Jesus Christ.
Allow me.
I haven't got time.
Please
I haven't got all the time
me.
In the world for you to talk
you're
about.
You're not being direct. You're not
sorry, this is biblical.
Really kind of
historicity of the death.
Can you allow me to speak?
Not
do you understand simple statements?
I'm linking it. If you allow me, I'm linking it.
We have allowed you for a long time.
Right.
When are you going to talk about the death, burial, resurrection, the historicity
please.
Of these events?
If you
can we do the direct approach, please?
If you don't interrupt,
this has been too long a conversation.
If you don't interrupt me, I can get to my end quicker. Right?
No,
so not only was he unjust in killing these, 1,400 years later.
I'm not, excuse me.
I
don't care. You're talking nonsense. We have an agreed. We have an
quoting the Bible. How is that nonsense?
The 10th plague is not. We have. Thank you. And I agree with the Quran. You finally agree with the Quran.
This is
nonsense. The Quran does not believe in the 10th plague.
Because you don't believe in the Bible. Because
you don't. You just said, I could do what you're doing. I could do what you're doing. Do you see? I didn't do that. So
because you were deviant in a different way.
Bro, just finish your point.
Excuse me. Dawood.
No one likes. Do you see? I can do what you're doing, but I don't.
I don't like. After we have agreed to talk about something, I don't like you talking about something else.
Perfect.
Calm down. Talk sense. Talk about the thing which we have agreed on.
I'm sorry. Me talking about the Bible seems unsensical because Muslims have been saying that it's unsensical.
This is silly. Right? Let me come back to you, sir.
Right.
Now that you have brought up the point of the Passover,
I want to understand.
Can you please agree in public that Quran denies the historicity of the Passover? Do you agree?
Bring me proof the Passover happened.
Exactly.
Bring me the proof. Hold on, hold on. Bring me proof.
In other words,
bring me
in
proof.
In other words,
Bible?
Bring me proof. In other words,
the
Christians and the Jews claim that there was an event called the Passover, whereas the Muslims reject that.
Hold on.
Are you on the same page?
Not the Passover, it's about Jesus.
Bring me proof that God killed innocent children of firstborns of Egyptians during the time of Moses. Was roughly which year? When did Moses exist?
I'm not here for a Q&A, sir. I'm here
after
to talk about.
Years
excuse me, Dawood. You might
bring
think.
Bring me proof. Please bring me proof.
Shall we agree that Quran rejects the Passover? Shall we agree on that?
Please bring me proof.
Shall we agree on that, please?
So the Passover event, the killing of innocent children.
But the Passover.
The
10th plague.
Bring me proof of the 10th plague. Please bring me proof.
The 10th plague.
Please bring me.
Before coming to the proofs, shall we agree?
Bring me proof of it.
Yeah,
can you hear?
Do you at least play
hold on.
Or not?
Bring me proof of it.
Exactly. That's exactly what I'm asking for. In other words.
Right. Now
in other
bring
words.
Proof. Do you believe in it?
Excuse
do you believe in it?
Please.
Okay,
in other words.
Arul, do you believe in it?
In other words.
Arul, do you believe in it? Arul, do you believe in it? Bring me proof. Bring me proof. Arul, you believe in it? Bring me proof.
In other words.
Arul, you
can
believe
I say. Muslims have been. Muslims have been spreading lies.
I can shout. Louder than you. Arul. I got a big cough. Now, Aki, bring the voice down, bring the volume down.
Now, Abdul, stay quiet and agree with simple premises first. Abdul, the simple point is,
the
simple point is, Muslims,
you do. Can you please bring me proof of it, please?
Ray, more importantly, this is the challenge.
Wait.
This is the challenge.
It's a separate topic, by the way.
No, it's the same.
The discussion about the proof is a separate
topic. Hold on,
no. We only ask about whether you believe
no,
in
no,
it.
No. You believe
we
in
only
it.
Ask them to believe.
You ask me whether or not belief
all.
Is based
That's
on
all.
What?
That's all right.
Is your belief based on something?
I'm telling you what we were.
Ray,
is it based on something?
More crucially.
Yeah, Arul, wait.
More crucially. Please don't touch me. Please don't touch me.
Okay.
More crucially, Ray, this is the challenge. Yeah, I've always seen Islam as the biggest hoax of human history, the biggest of it. A billion plus people and more throughout history have believed in a hoax. What is the important attribute of the hoax? Muslims have been going around claiming that Islam is an Abrahamic religion, that Islam is a logical next step of the Torah, of the Injil. That has been their claim. But did you see the basic problem with their claim? The Passover, and prior to that, the 10th plague of the slaughter of the firstborn sons, which goes hand in hand with the Passover, is the defining moment of the nation of Israel. The
now
moment.
Bring me evidence of it.
Please
bring
don't me push me.
Don't come too close. Bring me
excuse me, I'm standing here. Please don't touch me. The moment you deny the Passover, you are the worst anti-Semite ever. Islam is an anti-Semitic religion because it denies
the defining moment of the history of the nation of Israel.
Perfect.
And it has done that.
Have you done shouting?
And it has done that for hundreds of years. Yet they stand here, go around deceiving Jews. What do they say when Jews are around? They say, oh, we follow the same God. Oh, our claim that there is only one Allah is very similar to your Shema, and therefore we are both the followers of the same sort of Abrahamic religion. That has been their claim. But the deceivers.
This part on shaking hands.
I don't shake hands with an anti-Semite, my friend.
You want to shake hands?
Anti-Semite.
Denying anti-Semite.
Yes. Denying the defining moment of the nation of Israel. I have told you already.
Stop shouting at me.
Denying the defining moment.
Do you see anyone else shouting?
Excuse
Why are you the
me,
only one shouting?
Ask a question. Stay quiet now if you need an answer.
It's Ray shouting. No one else shouted. Why
denying.
Do you not know how to behave?
Excuse me, don't
Jesus
touch me.
Did Jesus not teach you? I'm not touching you.
You
Jesus,
touch me.
Did Jesus not teach you how
to behave? Denying the defining moment of the nation of Israel is an anti-Semitic act. How clearer could I explain this?
Prove you've lost.
Denying the Passover.
Right, mate, take care.
Denying the Passover.
A shouter is lost.
Anti-Semitic act you could ever do. And that is precisely what you have done. And that is precisely what Islam has done.
Lovely conversation.
Islam,
between humans,
as a religion,
and a shouter.
Despite the fact that...
What we're saying here, man.
Despite the fact that they go around claiming that they follow the same God as the nation of Israel, fundamentally differ. What we have in the Bible, the nation of Israel begins with the Passover, with the sacrificial lamb. Islam does not have it. Islam denies it. Islam doesn't account for it. If you ask anyone with a preliminary education on the Bible, and if you ask them how many plagues were there in Egypt during the time of Moses, how many would they say, brother?
Nine.
Now, how many would the Bible believers say?
Ten.
So the Bible believers would say there were 10 plagues. But what would a Muslim say?
Nine.
Why would they say it's only nine?
Because the 10th plague is the Passover. Passover foreshadows Jesus Christ coming. So therefore, as far as Allah was concerned, he doesn't want to reveal the Passover because it foreshadows Jesus Christ coming as the Lamb of God that will take away the sins of the world.
In other words, the fact of the matter is, Islam has been designed to deny... has been designed to deny the defining moment of the nation of Israel, has been designed to deny the defining thing of Christianity, which is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Perfect.
If someone deliberately, by design, goes against Israel, undermining their historicity, would it be sensible to call them an anti-Semite?
To say so, yeah, because it's from Shem.
So to deny their very existence as a nation, as a result of the Passover, makes Islam an anti-Semitic religion. Now let's go to the Christians, to Christ, to deny the very center of Christian belief, which is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The very fact of having a design which says Jesus was never crucified, he never died, would it be sensible, brother, to call such a belief anti-Christian? In other words, Islam by design is both anti-Semitic and anti-Christian, denying the defining moments of the nation of Israel and of Christians, denying it. Now, Okay, if we take a slightly flexible approach in this and we say, okay, maybe the Quran is right in saying these things haven't happened, then the question that we'd like to ask is, what is the evidence? The fact of Passover is very part and parcel of the history of the nation of Israel. The fact of the Passover, it's what is called Pesach, the Passover. It's part and parcel of the history of the nation of Israel. Even today, Jews across the world celebrate Pesach. And we have historical records which go back even before Christ outside of the Bible, which record of this Passover sacrifice. Outside of the Bible, from before even the time of Jesus, we have historical records of the fact of the Jews celebrating Passover. It's such a part and parcel. It's such a part and parcel of the history of the nation of Israel. On what basis a religion which comes very many centuries later, on what basis was it going to deny the Passover? Was it going to deny the 10th plague? Was it going to deny the death, burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ, especially the death and burial, at the least?
Yeah, at the least.
At the least. On what basis does the Quran reject these things? If you go and ask a Muslim, on what basis do you do that? The only thing they could say is, because Muhammad said so. Because the Quran says so. Someone who is from Arabia, who couldn't read and write properly, who wasn't properly educated, who couldn't convince that he was from God through any supernatural sign or wonder, is no credible source to rewrite history. Would any one of us today take the example of a person who came centuries after a particular event
in a different country,
in a different country,
of a different lineage,
of a different lineage, who wasn't educated enough, who couldn't convince that he was from God through any sign or wonder,
preach another gospel,
preach things completely contradictory to history, contradictory to the Bible, why would anyone take him seriously?